please, to the book of Genesis, chapter 32. Genesis, chapter 32, where we'll read together in just a few moments, beginning at verse 24. You'll recognize this scripture as you turn there as that event in the life of Jacob. Jacob has been living in a foreign land. Jacob has been there for years as he labors with his father-in-law, and now he reaches a point in his life when he says, I cannot stay here any longer, and whatever takes place, I'm going back home. And so chapter 32 is that whole event where Jacob gets up and he starts back home. Several things happen. In verse 2, the Bible tells us, or verse 1 rather, tells us that some angels met him. As he comes along his way, some angels meet with him. And he claims that from God. And he asks God then to be aware of him. But even with that, now he knows that he's got to go back home and face his brother Esau. Esau, you remember, those years before, had declared, when my daddy dies, I'm going to kill my brother. So Jacob has been living under a death threat for all of those years. And folks, I want you to know it's never a fun thing to live under a death threat. You say, preacher, have you ever been there? I have. And I want you to know it's not a fun place to be. I hope you never go there. But Jacob has been living that way, but now circumstances in his life change to the point where he says, I'm willing to take my chances. If I can straighten out what I messed up so long time ago. And you remember that he says, I know what I'll do, and he divides much of his cattle, things that he had worked hard to get. And he said, I'll give all of this to my brother, and maybe I can appease him and get out from under the threat that I've been living under for all this time. And so he sends his servants ahead. They come back and they tell him, Jacob, your brother's coming, and he's got 400 soldiers with him. Now, if you got word like that, what would you do? Well, Jacob said, divide the camp, put the women and the children over here, and then Jacob goes across a little brook called Peniel. And there that night, he wrestles with God. What I want you to see in the outset, Jacob's problem was not his brother. Jacob's problem was not even God. But Jacob's problem was Jacob. If you could write a letter to God tonight and ask him for any one thing, what would you ask him for? Some of you quickly would say, God, if I could ask you for one thing and know that you would hear my prayer, I would ask you to grant me a restored health. Some of you here today, you have suffered for years and years with some kind of malady that has destroyed you. You've lived with pain. You've lived with anguish. You've lived under the threat of doctors that you're only going to get worse as time goes by. And every day that you live, you wonder if this pain will be the one that will take me out, or if this day will be my last day upon the earth. And if you could ask God for one thing tonight, you'd say, God, I want you to give me my health. Some others of you would say, God, if I could write you a letter and ask you for one thing, I'd pray that you would hear my prayer and save my family. Oh God, my husband is lost and I love him so, and he's on his way to hell, and I can't stand the thought of us being separated for eternity. And God, if I could ask you for one thing, I'd pray for my husband. It may be a husband saying, I'd pray for my wife, or it might be parents saying, Lord, I love my child. I've poured my whole heart and my whole life into my child. And God, if you could hear just one prayer that I have, it would be that my daughter, my son, would turn around from their wickedness and come and call on God. Oh God, if I could. And you've wrestled with their wayward children. You've wrestled with their heartache. You've wrestled with the shame that they brought upon you and the family. And you've begged God. And if you tonight thought, I can ask just for one thing, you would ask for your family to be saved. Others would admit that you're in a period of deep discouragement and depression, and your one desire is that somewhere down the road, if God would just give you a little bit of hope, an inkling that somewhere, surely there's going to be light at the end of this dark tunnel that I'm going through. If you've never suffered from depression, perhaps you don't know what that's like. But I'm going to tell you, friend, there is nothing, I'm convinced, in the world that is as bad as being in a slough of despondency that you can't get out of. And that can come from any number of sources in your life. But there's someone maybe here tonight that's saying, oh God, if I had just one thing that I could beg you for, I'd beg you, God, that I could get up and believe that the sun is going to shine on my world today. If I could just start another day and believe that it's going to be right between me and you, or between me and my world, that I'm going to get this cloud off of my mind, that I'm going to be able to get out from under the burden that I'm bearing. That's the one thing, God, that I would ask you for. Now, with that said, I want you to find Jacob. And I begin at verse 24. And Jacob was left alone. I need to stop there long enough to say to you that another thing that the enemy brings against us is loneliness. Loneliness. I maybe there's no greater enemy than that. You remember the story of Robinson Crusoe, who was stranded on the deserted island, no one to talk to, and how that after a long time he found a place where he could go and shout, and an echo of his own voice would come back just to hear the sound of a human voice. Some of you know what that's like as you deal with the loneliness of your everyday world. And Jacob was left alone. Have you ever been surrounded by people and feel like that you were the only person in the world? I've been there once or twice. I perhaps shouldn't tell you, but I will. Years ago, we had only been in our fellowship building a short time, and we had a fire. I was seated in my office studying. Miss Eileen Cox was in the outer office. And our janitor had been mowing grass where this building is. We didn't even own this land. But there was a lawn, and he had been out mowing grass. And he stopped his mower, got off, walked all the way around the church, came back in to where our offices were in the administration building. And when he came in, he just said as he walked by the door, somebody ought to call the fire department. Langston Baptist Church is on fire. I thought, dear God in heaven. I jumped up and ran out of the office and caught him as he was going out the back door. I said, what did you say? He said, the building's on fire. And by this time, I could see the smoke was billowing out of the top of the thing. And I'm telling you, have you ever wanted to pinch somebody's head? I mean, that's, well, I ran to see, and the fire had started in the kitchen area, and it had engulfed that whole area there. I grabbed the fire extinguisher and got down under the smoke and could see where some of the flames were. And I tried to put it out, and of course that didn't slow it down much. And I hollered for him to get me another one, and he said, "Where are they?" And again, I wanted to say, "Man, have you worked here this long?" And I tried to tell him, and he started running, or didn't run, he started walking. And he got me one, brought it back, and I'm down under the smoke, got my handkerchief over my nose, and I'm fighting it. And then I told him, "Get me a water hose and bring it." And I'm still trying to keep the building from burning completely to the ground. And I was able to slow it down enough that by the time the fire department got here, they got the fire out. But they said it was just before breaking into the upstairs. And if it had gotten into that upstairs area, it would have burned everything we had down. So now the fire's out, and they're rolling up their hoses. People are everywhere. And I'm standing over, leaning up against the fence around one of the air conditioners, blowing smoke and all of that out of my lungs and out of my nose. And nobody would talk to me. I thought, "Oh Lord, they think I set it on fire." I felt like I was the loneliest person in the world at that moment, because of what had happened. And no one, I mean no one, would come near me for a long time. Well, Jacob is alone. And in the loneliness of the night, it's dark. And by the way, wherever loneliness comes, it's always dark. And Jacob is in the darkness of the night, and he is alone. Now listen to what he says. "And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day." Now I just need to stop long enough to tell you, and you'll see it in just a little while, that this man that Jacob is wrestling with is not a man. This man is none other than God Himself. Many believe that this is Jesus Christ in one of those Old Testament manifestations that we find many times. And he's wrestling with him. And if you'll read further on, I believe it's down about verse 30 that he says, and let me just put my finger on it. Verse 30, the name of the place Peniel, "For I have seen God face to face and lived." So he's wrestling with God. Have you ever wrestled with God? "And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, 'Let me go, for the day breaketh.' And Jacob said," and he said, Jacob, "'I will not let thee go, except thou bless me.' And he said unto him, 'What is thy name?' And he said, 'Jacob.' And he said, 'Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince thou hast power with God and with men, and hast prevailed.' And Jacob asked him and said, 'Tell me, I pray thee, thy name.' And he said, 'Wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name?'" Now listen. "And he blessed him there." Now, I want you to consider several things with me tonight. Number one, I want you to consider Jacob's desperation. If you look back at verse 7, the Bible there says that Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed. Jacob is in a pickle, as we say it in our world today. He's between a rock and a hard place. He don't have anywhere to turn. He is at a point where any way he goes is wrong. He can't go back to where his father-in-law is, because he's going to kill him. He's afraid to go back to where his brother is, because he's going to kill him. Any way he turns, Jacob is in trouble. He's in his deepest valley. Why? Because he had deceived his brother and then run for his life. You remember the story, how he came in from the field and he took advantage of the situation and he took his brother's birthright. He got the blessing. That means that he was going to be the one who would receive a double portion of whatever his father had that belonged to Esau. But he tricked his dad into giving it to him. And when Esau heard it, he said, I'll kill him. I'll kill him. I'll kill him. He had to run for his life. And he went to another country. He went back to the homeland of his father. And there he found his uncle by the name of Laban. And he took him. And you remember that how he had tricked his brother? What he sowed back then now comes up in his own life. And he saw a woman, and oh, she was beautiful. And he said, I will marry you. Where have you been all my life? And so he said to his father-in-law-to-be, he said, I want to marry her. And they made an agreement that he could. But when they had the party, the wedding feast, and they went to bed, it was night, it was dark, they didn't have night lights in the room. And when he woke up the next morning, instead of that beautiful girl, he's got her ugly sister instead. Now that'll bless your life. And he complains to the father and he says, well, it's our custom that we can't allow the younger to be married before the elder, but if you'll agree to work with me 7 more years. He's already in debt for 7 years. And now for 7 more. He said, you can have her too. And so he agreed, and he says, the scripture says that Jacob said that 14 years seemed like nothing for his love for Rachel. Wow, that's a real love story. But now he has tricked his father-in-law. He's learned how to crossbreed cattle, and he agrees with the father-in-law that all of the animals that are born that I'm watching over that are spotted and streaked, I'll take them and you keep all the solid colors. And so Laban looked around. Everything he had except one or two was solid colors. He said, okay. And so Jacob figured out how to cross those things up. And man, everything was coming out spotted and streaked. And the father-in-law comes out. He said, I made a bad deal. I'm changing the rules. I take all that's spotted and streaked. You get all of those that are solid colors. Next spring when they start dropping their young, they're all solid colors. Everything that Jacob puts his hand, he's learned how to take advantage of a situation. A lot of people today are like that. But it got so bad, as a matter of fact, his father-in-law changed the rules 10 times in the years that he worked for him. But he kept getting poorer and his son-in-law kept getting richer. And finally he said, because the blood had gotten so embroiled between him and his father-in-law and brothers-in-law, that they're all going to kill him and take what he has. And he says to his wives, get the children. We're out of here. And so they run. And in doing so, they stole the idols that Laban was worshiping. And man, he comes chasing them then, sure enough, in order to fight against him and to kill him. He's in a mess. He can't go back. He can't go forward. And he crosses the brook. And there he wrestles in the dark with God all night long. He's in a desperate situation. It's the darkest hour of his life. But may I point out to you that the darkest hour was one that God had prepared in order to come to him. He's the greatest blessing is when he's at his lowest point. And when you are in a similar situation and it looks like there's no way for you to turn, don't panic. It may just be that it's in that time when God has chosen that he's going to give you a miracle. In that time when God is going to show you his mighty power. Second thing I want you to see. appreciate his determination. Look at verse 26. He has been wrestling all night. Not only is he wrestling with him, but now he has become debilitated. His hip is out of joint. And I want you to know, if you've ever had something like that, you can imagine how bad a pain that is. There's some people here who've had new hip joints put in because of the pain that you've had. His is out of joint. But he says, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Bless me, Lord. Bless me. And folks, I want to say to you that Jacob could have given up and he had never known what God had in mind. You remember the story in the New Testament where this little widow woman comes to the judge and she says, I want you to help me with my adversaries. I've got real troubles. And the judge said, I ain't got time for you. Leave me alone. But everywhere that judge turned, there's that little woman tugging on his coattail, saying, you've got to help me, you've got to help me. And the Bible says that the judge said to the servants, give her whatever she wants so that I can be rid of this. But he did that not because of the goodness of his heart, but because of her unfortunate inabilities to work for herself. I want you to know that God understands where you are, and God knows the trouble you're in, and God knows the hardships that you face, and God understands. But I'm going to tell you one thing. Those people who stay with God are those who find the power and blessings of God, and those who give up every time some little problem comes along are those who never know the delivering power of God. See, a lot of folks, first little problem that comes, they blame God and quit. Never go to church again. Sometimes a situation comes along and they don't understand, and they blame God, or they blame the church, or they blame the preacher. By the way, if you have not anybody else to blame, blame the preacher. But when you do that, you'll never know the blessings that God has in store for you. And he held on. He held on to God. And God, as he always does, came through. Third thing, I want you to hear what God said to him. He said, what is thy name? Verse 27. What is thy name? Now, why would divinity ask mortality a question? I mean, after all, doesn't God know everything? Doesn't he? Then why in the world would he ask, was God having a senior moment? Some of you know what that is, don't you? You stand in front of the mirror with your pills in your hand and you say, now did I take these or am I getting ready to take them? Got a senior moment. Some of us are finding out that they come more regularly than we ever dreamed. Was God in a place that he had just forgotten and couldn't remember who this was? After all, did he not create man and give man his name, and he called Adam by his name? Did not God call Abraham his forebear from another part of the world? Did God forget? Is that why he said, what is your name? Is God having a senior moment? Why does God ask? Why did God ask Adam? Adam, where are you? Does not the Bible say that the eyes of the Lord run to and fro upon the earth, and that there's nothing that is hid from him? And yet he walked into the garden that night and he said, Adam, where are that day? And he said, Adam, where are you? Was it that God didn't know? Oh no. But Adam had to come to the point to where he said, I'm over here, God. Why are you hiding? Because I was naked. Who told you you was naked? God knew all of those answers, and yet he's making man deal with his own situation. Why did he ask Cain, where is your brother? I mean, after all, the Bible tells us that the blood of Abel had cried out from the earth, and God heard, and God knew where his body was buried. But he said to Abel, "Where is your brother?" Why did God ask that? Was not it because Cain is now having to come to face his own sin and give an account to God? By the way, the Bible does say, does it not? Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. And there'll be a time when something will happen in your world and you'll look around and say, "Oh God, why?" And immediately in your brain, the answer will come echoing down through the corridors of your mind, and it'll say, "Do you remember when you sowed this seed? And it's harvest time." Why did he ask? Why? What is thy name? And by the way, this is not the first time that Jacob has been asked what his name is. For when he brought the venison in for his father, and there his old daddy is blind, and he's put the goat hairs on his arms because Esau's a hairy man. And he said, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Esau." He lied. He tricked his old daddy. This is not the first time he's been asked, "What is your name?" But now he's in a place that he can't deceive the one he's wrestling with. He got by with his daddy. His daddy said, "You smell like your brother, but your voice doesn't sound like your brother." But he can't deceive God when God said, "What is your name?" And what did he say? Jacob. See, the name Jacob is the name that he had been given by his parents, but he had done everything he could to live up to that name, because the name Jacob means one who is a trickster, someone who is a deceiver, somebody who takes advantage of others. And he has lived his whole life trying to live up to his name. Some of you know what that means, do you not? I don't know what the number of times that I said to my children as they were going away from our home, when they were young, I'd say, "Now remember whose child you are. Don't do anything that would hurt our name." I hear my daddy saying, "Son, the most valuable thing you've got is your name. Don't ever do anything to lose it." I met a man not long ago. His name was Randall. And I told him that was my name. I said, "You take care of our name now. Don't you let somebody think that you might be me and mess up. You have to take care." What's your name? Jacob. Jacob. And I hate what I am. He didn't hate who he was, but he hated what he was. And folks, I want you to know, until you come to a point in your life where you have to admit, "I don't like what I am, and I don't like what I'm doing, and I don't like anything about my life, because I know it's displeasing to God," it's only then that you can know the blessings of God in your life. Wow. What's your name? Now he asks in order not to find out, but to solicit a confession. In other words, God says, if you want a blessing, you're going to have to confess the truth about yourself. You remember the story? Jesus is down by the Sea of Galilee, and there are the disciples out in their boats. They've been fishing all night, and they're just some yards away from shore. And maybe Jesus cupped his hands to his lips and he said, "Have you any meat?" And they answered, "We have labored all night, and we hadn't got the first sardine. We've not taken a single fish." Jesus said, "Cast your net on the other side." And boy, when they did, they got so many. They filled the boats. The nets was about to break. The boats was about to sink with a load of fish they caught. Of course, old Peter said, "It's the Lord." Why did he know that? By the way, when he said, "Have you any meat?" did he know what they'd been doing all night? Hey, he's the one that had arranged that. He's the one that said, "All those little fish, you go down the other end of the lake now. They're coming out here with nets." He had kept those fish away from them all night long. They couldn't catch a thing. And now he says, "Cast your nets on the other side." Just as easy as it was to keep the blessing away, now he lets the blessing come into their net. "Have you any meat? What's your name? Why are you hiding? Where is your brother?" In order to get the blessing, there had to first come a confession of their need. My brothers and sisters, there's no mountain without a valley. There is no healing without a sickness. There is no fulfillment without a need. And where you are, you may be in that place where Jacob is, but it just may be that God has been arranging for this moment in your life when He can pour out the wonders of glory on your life. As you confess and hold on to Him. I've got to stop, but there's one last thing you need to see. There was a disguise to Jacob's blessing. Did you see? And he blessed him there. He blessed him there. And he changed his name from Jacob to Israel. Before he's been a deceiver, now he's a prince of God. And he comes back the next morning and he says to his family, "All right, let's go face the music. Let's go face Esau." And he starts to where Esau is. But something's happened. What happened? God, you remember, touched his hip. And everywhere now he walks. And he drags that old foot. And he steps. And he drags that old foot. And again, because his hip is out of joint, it won't go back. The Bible says the sinew, the muscle around that shrank. And so all the rest of his life, old Jacob's going to be known as a cripple. But he was crippled in order to be crowned. And let's go find him. Somebody says, "Yonder he comes." And there he is right out front. 400 men, soldiers with him. And Jacob, the Bible says, took a step, drug that old crippled foot, and bowed down to the earth. And he got up and he walked a little further and he bowed down 7 times. He did that. What he was saying to his brother was, "I'm bowing before you. I know that I'm an enemy. I know that I'm defeated." And he's expecting when Esau gets there for him to stick his foot on the back of his neck and maybe to cut it off. But he humbled himself. When you've met with God and when you have confessed to God, and even though you have been crowned by God, I'm telling you, that there will be an humbling in your life. Why did Esau put his arms around him? Why did Esau said, "I don't need all these cattle. Why, I've got more now than I need"? Why did Esau welcome him back home and weep on him because he was come back home? I believe it's because when he saw Jacob coming, Jacob wasn't walking proud. Jacob wasn't showing off his family and his cattle. Jacob is crippled. And he's coming back and bowing at his brother's feet. "I have the birthright. but I'm willing to yield to anything you want in my life. There's a disguise in the blessing. Jacob is going to have to learn a new song. Learning to lean. I'm learning to lean. For the rest of his life, he'll have to lean on somebody or on a crutch because he's crippled. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. There was a disguise in the blessing. One of my favorite people of all time is a woman by the name of Fanny Crosby. In our old hymn book, we had 21 of her songs that we sang time after time after time. One of my favorite of those, "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Hath Done, Blessed Assurance, Jesus Is Mine, A Wonderful Savior Is Jesus My Lord, I Am Thine, O Lord." 21 of her hymns, just in our hymn book. But Fanny Crosby was blind. And most of her songs, she said, came out of her blindness. When she was just an infant, she got cold in her eyes, and her daddy went to a doctor, and he was a quack, and he gave her some medicine that was intended for animals like horses and stuff, and they put it on her eyes, and it blinded her. And for all of her years, she could not see. And by the way, the song that she wrote, that to me is one of the greatest songs of all, comes out of that blindness when she wrote, "And I shall see him face to face." I shall see him face to face. It was on one occasion when Fanny Crosby was visiting a prison, and they had ministered to a number of the inmates there. And as they were leaving, they were passing by the infirmary. And she heard a voice saying, "Don't pass me by. Don't pass me by." And she stopped and she said to the others, "Do you hear that cry?" And turning back, they went in, and here is a prisoner who is lying there and he's near to death. And he has heard the message that has been delivered to others and heard their prayers and God's deliverance. And now as they step up to the bed, he's saying it over, "Don't pass me by." And they present Christ, and he calls out to God just before he's called out to meet God. And all that night she said that she could not rest. And that word just kept turning over and over in her mind. "Don't pass me by. Don't pass me by." And out of that came our song, "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry while on others thou art calling. Do not pass me by." The disguise of the blessing is that it came in a way that Jacob did not anticipate. But when Jacob got to that place to where he said, "Lord, I'm desperate. I'm at the end of myself. I don't know which way to go. There's nothing that I can do. And God, it's true. It's true. My name is Deceiver, and I've done everything I can to live up to that name. I've sinned against heaven in thy sight. Oh, dear God, be merciful unto me." And God blessed him there. You just may be at that point in your life that God has chosen to give you your miracle. You just may be at that point when, unless God comes through, you don't know which way to go, and you're a prime candidate for an outpouring of heaven. Bless me, Lord. If you could write a letter to God, what's the one thing you'd ask Him for when you get desperate enough? You'll not let go of God, and you'll confess to God, and you just may hear the Lord say, "What's your name?" And He'll bless you there. Let's pray. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that You'll make